Hello and welcome to another segment, a special segment of DSU Inside Perspective. I'm Carlos Holmes, and today we're on part three of our interview with Dr. Harry L. Williams, the president, the 10th president of Delaware State University, who's leaving to become the CEO and president of the Thurgood Marshall College Fund. But before he leaves here, we got to talk about his tenure and get this down for history's sake.
Thank you, Carlos.
Delaware State University, back in the day, I'm going to say 30 or 40 years ago, you didn't say Delaware State University and research, scientific research, right, in the same sentence. Right. Now it is an indelible part of our characteristic as a university. And during your tenure, we saw some developments such as increasing our portfolio in our neuroscience program, in our optics program, in our chemistry programs. We saw the construction of a new optical science center for applied research. And that seemed to be geared toward optics. Right. But something new happened about the time that we were dedicating that building. And under your leadership, we also established a Delaware Institute for Science and Technology that appeared to be taking us in a direction that goes beyond optics. What is that disc? We call it discs,
right,
to be short.
Right. Right. So let me, first of all, before I even answer that question, let me kind of put the foundation in place in terms of that created an opportunity for Delaware State to be now equal partners with some of the research collaborations that we've been able to establish. And I go back to Dr. Mashu, who was a scientist himself, mathematician, who saw the value in bringing in faculty with some science background. And Dr. Mashu, as you know, served for over 27 years as president. Then he transitioned to another scientist in Dr. DeLauder. And Dr. Bill DeLauder, who came from Norfolk A&T, who was a dean at the time when he came here, but he was also a scientist. And Dr. Lauder really started to build up the I call it the infrastructure to create opportunities for this land grant university to use its outreach arm within the ag piece, but also the research piece, and create more opportunities so they brought more scientists in. And so he used that because he knew there were opportunities at federal level for grants from NIH, NSF, you know, things of that nature. So he brought in some really top-notch scientists. And then you come to Dr. Alan Sessoms. And Sessoms, who was a physicist, who really saw the power of the opportunity there, and he really put a lot of money into it, a lot of incentives for faculty members. So then they started thinking about this culture of creating a culture where people can go and do research, and then you follow that with Dr. Smith, who was a chemist from DuPont, and so you got a foundation there that the culture starts thinking differently. And then here I come. I'm not a scientist, but I saw the value of supporting this initiative and creating opportunities for people to create wins. So in the DIS Center, you know, we have the Center for Neuroscience,
right,
which Dr. Melissa Harrington wrote a grant through NIH. First grant, she received about $10.9 million. It was the largest grant we've ever seen at one time. And she did an outstanding job, went through the five-year renew process. We built the infrastructure around to support that. Just here last couple weeks ago, we announced another five-year grant for $10.9 million. So that's over a 10-year period, one person, with the help of a team, has brought in more than $20 million to work on a center for neuroscience on the campus of Delaware State.
And we're working with UD, but we're the lead agency here.
And that's a first. We have never, when we partnered with these major grants, typically we're like the sub partner, meaning that we come to the dance with you and we let you lead. In this particular case, we are leading. And it's one of the largest grants, the largest grant in the history of this institution. So we are heading in the right direction. Our faculty members are focused on it. Our ag, millions of dollars coming in to the ag department, some of the research that they're doing over there. Our biology faculty members, our chemistry faculty members, they are working really, really hard. But we're also spreading it out to the humanities. You know, we don't want to leave them out because, you know, people say that, you know, we don't have a lot of grants in the humanities. Well, that's true. But the money is in the hard sciences, the STEM areas. So we've put some support around that, and I feel that Delaware State is in a position where they're going to compete for even more, because it's got a reputation of being a major land grant in this country, and part of that will attract. And this grant that we got from the neuroscience, we're going to build on that, because that grant not only partners with biology, but there's some work going on with ag, there's some work going on with chemistry. So there's an interdisciplinary approach to it. We even got someone from the humanities who's doing some of the writing parts of it. So there are so many opportunities that I think that's going to keep elevating our profile as a major, major institution, not only in the state of Delaware, but in the country.
Now, we made a conscious decision to take our STEM, our science, technology, engineering, and mathematics emphasis below the undergraduate level, and we established an early college high school.
Yep.
How does that, in your mind, connect us with what we're doing here on the undergraduate and graduate
level? It's a direct connection, because you got to have a pipeline of students thinking about this. So what we did 4 years ago, it was just a dream. We were approached by Senator Carper, came to me and met with me, and Dr. Alton Thompson, who was the provost at the time, and said, "What do you guys think about an early college high school?" Well, we said, "Well, tell us more." It's a college high school that focused on STEM, focus on students graduating in 4 years from high school, starting in ninth grade. And the catch to it, these students not only would have a high school diploma, but they will have enough credit, potentially earn up to 60 hours of college credit in college classes on a college campus. And that was a unique concept for us. Didn't have a single one in the state. I said, "Let's do it." And we went through that process. We brought our first cohort in. We're now in our senior class for that first cohort, which is exciting. And the goal with that program is to, again, create a pipeline of all the students who are in that, close to 100 students in that program their senior year. Every last one of those students have applied to Delaware State. And we're not going to get them all, because we're encouraging them to apply to other places, like, you know, the parents. But this is what I'm excited about, and this is very timely. This first cohort, that the number one student in the senior class, her mother emailed the principal over the weekend and said she got her acceptance letter. She did early admissions to a very prestigious school, and she got in. And that school is Stanford University.
Oh my goodness.
And she got in, she was accepted at Stanford, and she's going to graduate from Delaware State Early College High School. Another parent emailed and said that her daughter did early admissions, got a full scholarship to Spelman College. So we're building a foundation that people from all over the country already recognize and say, "That's talent." And these students are coming from Delaware. Now, we're going to end up with about 75, maybe 80% of those students who apply will come to Delaware State. And that's going to help us with our in-state numbers. That's also going to help us with our graduation, because these kids are coming in. Most of these students, when they start their freshman year, they're going to have enough credits where they are juniors. And they'll be able to graduate in 2 years, because they're going to bring their high school diploma, and they're going to bring all the college credits that they've earned while they were here in school. So that's a pretty good deal.
In your tenure, nobody could accuse you of not making a hard decision. And you made the hard decision to take a strong look at our major structure. And you had a process in place that engaged our faculty and our staff, and to look hard at our majors and what was working and what was not working.
Right.
What is attracting students and what's not. And we actually did something that most people say that no other university is doing, unless they're under duress.
Right.
This was not a case where we were under duress,
that's
but
great.
We cut some majors out.
Right.
We actually lowered the number
right.
of undergraduate degrees. Talk about that process.
Yeah, and what you're referencing is something that is very hard to do in the academy, because once there's nothing more precious than a degree program. And when you start talking about eliminating or sunsetting or deactivating degree programs, that get people all worked up.
Which, to be accurate, that's what we did. We deactivated
those programs, which means it's a difference between eliminating
right.
and deactivating. Deactivating meaning that at this time, this degree, we don't have enough students who are interested in this degree program. So from a financial standpoint, to have a faculty member say make $100,000 teaching four students, that's not a good economic decision. So what we want to do is take that faculty member, put him or her in the appropriate class where we'll have 30 students, 35 maximum. So we're getting the benefit of that person's talent, but the students also are benefiting from it as well. Mm-hmm. So we had to look at those, what we call low performing programs, where they have low enrollment, and take a hard look and make some tough decisions around that. And we did. It took us 2 years to get there. The community was engaged. We deactivated 23 academic programs. It made national news right. when we did that. It made the front page of the news journal because mm-hmm. they didn't think a college would take on that. And the headlines was that we had to do this to preserve our future, because you don't spend all your resources when you can use those dollars and repurpose them and put mm-hmm. them into programs like this particular major right here. Communication is booming here at this institution. Mm-hmm. This is a big popular major here at the school. So you can take more the resources from some mm-hmm. of those low-end, low-producing programs, and you can shift mm-hmm. those resources over here. We shared that with our General Assembly. We shared that with our major stakeholders, mm-hmm. and they were just amazed that we were able to do it without very much controversy around it, which, again, it was the process we put in place, the open communication that we put in place, mm-hmm. and the reality that we're looking at preserving Delaware State. And when you take all that into consideration, people know you're making the right decision for the institution.
One other thing that you've been able to accomplish since you've been here has been to create this culture of giving, okay? And it appears that our alumni giving numbers are better.
Yep, they are.
I don't know if they're where they need to be yet. Right. They probably could be improved upon, but they're certainly better than they used to be.
Absolutely.
And do you believe that we can even get better at this?
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things, is another indicator of the health of the institution is who's giving to your institution. Mm-hmm. And if your alums are giving, that's a very good sign. Mm-hmm. And when I started, we had single digits in terms mm-hmm. of the alums giving back. And now we're up approaching 15%. You said 15%, really not that. Just not that good. Well, if you look at where we started right. and look where we're heading, I was talking to someone at some major universities, they're at 9%.
But how did we do it? How did we get our numbers up?
We did it with working with our alums, talking to them and mm-hmm. bringing them back in and communicating mm-hmm. with them about the successes, taking advantage mm-hmm. of taking a show on the road, so to mm-hmm. speak, and going out and talking That's to right. our alums in New York mm-hmm. and talking to our alums in New Jersey and going out North Carolina. We were able to kind of build those bridges in a very positive way.
So this caused them to reconnect with us.
Right, right. Yeah. That was deliberate, mm-hmm. intentional, very mm-hmm. intentional.
Okay. Well, I guess I want to wind this up. You know I'm a history freak when yep. it comes to yep. Delaware State University.
A very good history guy,
well,
too.
And I plan to keep doing that. This is what this is all about, right, this interview right. series we've done here. And you've studied the history. You know about the legacy of Dr. DeLauder and Dr. Michoud and Dr. Holland and those that came before. What do you want DSU history to say about your legacy here? What do you think that should stand out for in people's evaluation of your tenure?
You know, I think part of this process when you're a president is that you're only in the race for a certain time frame. And you have a baton that you're carrying. Mm-hmm. And that baton, you're racing. And you're racing really, really fast. And your job is to, when you pass that baton to that next person, that they can look, you can look behind you and know that you have done an outstanding job and people can see it. And you know, sometimes when you're racing, and if you got a really big lead, you know, that gives people some comfort. Mm-hmm. And if you got someone, that means that you've worked really hard to get that lead. I would like to think that when I pass this baton, that Delaware State is a long ways down the road from where we started when I got this mm-hmm. baton. And this person that I'm gonna pass it on to will be able to stretch that lead even farther, because people are coming at us. So mm-hmm. it's a big, it's a major race, mm-hmm. and you have to be in it for the long haul, mm-hmm. and it's not a sprint, it's a distance race. And part of that is having the endurance to withstand all mm-hmm. the challenges that's gonna come your way. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, you wanna cross that finish line, and when you pass that baton on, you're in first place when you do that, and you're gonna, and the next person is gonna maintain that lead. So I feel that when we're at this place, you know, that we have a smooth transition. We've got an outstanding board chairwoman in Dr. Wilma Mashu, and I'm gonna pass that baton on to her. And I feel that she's got a nice, comfortable lead, but I know she's gonna run real fast to protect that lead so that we can protect all the things that we have here at Delaware mm-hmm. State. So it's been a fun journey. Mm-hmm. It's been an exciting journey. But as you know, you wanna make sure that when you leave a place, that it's better off than when you started. And I feel that we're in that place here at Delaware State.
Well, from this seat here, it's been an honor and a privilege for me to serve under you. Mm-hmm. And I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
We're not saying goodbye because you're just going up the road to Thurgood Marshall College Fund. Yep. And yep. now we're along with the other HBCUs that you're going to be advocating for.
Absolutely.
And so we look forward to continuing our relationship with you and having you look on Delaware State University with pride where you see where we're headed in future years.
Absolutely.
So thank you so much for taking out
right,
the time to go over your tenure with us here at Delaware State University. And thank you for joining us for this piece of history here on DSU Inside Perspective, the almost 8-year tenure of Dr. Harry L. Williams, 2010 to 2018, yeah. Yes, just into 2018. Good luck to you, Dr.
Thank
Williams.
Thank you.
Godspeed to you. And y'all have a good day.